He lived from 1861 to 1945, a time of tremendous change in America, from the musket to the nuclear bomb, from the carriage to the convertible, from the mounted courier to the television newsman. But Professor Jesse Beery brought the public something that was timeless, a glimpse into the mind of the horse. Although Jesse Beery was known in many countries, the center of his universe was Pleasant Hill, Ohio, about 30 miles north of Dayton. In the summer of 2007, his grandchildren and great-grandchildren met there to share their memories of him, and they invited me to join them. It was a chance to immerse myself in Beery's life, to examine the tools of his trade, to see the community where he lived, to talk to people who knew him, and to visit his grave. Most of all, it gave me a chance to get to know Jesse Beery's horsemanship and to find out just how relevant it is today. Jesse Beery was born on a farm 2 miles east of Pleasant Hill, Ohio, on June 13, 1861. He was a dedicated son and worked on the family farm with his father, Enoch, until he was an adult. But farming didn't suit young Jesse. He spent every spare minute playing with the family's horses, training them and teaching them tricks. He learned all on his own how horses think. He began taking in problem horses to earn extra money, enough to pay someone else to do his farm chores. But one day, after seeing Jesse nearly kicked in the head by a particularly vicious horse, Enoch gave Jesse an ultimatum. He said, "Either quit fooling around here with dangerous horses or quit the farm." Jesse decided to quit the farm, and he was estranged from his father for the next 2 years. So, at the age of 27, Jesse Beery became a full-time horse trainer, and the following year he made another important commitment. On Christmas Day of 1889, Jesse Beery married Almeda Kopic, whose family owned the neighboring farm outside Pleasant Hill. Jesse liked to say, "I just didn't see any point of looking any farther." In the years that followed, Beery gave demonstrations at fairs and expositions around the country. Everywhere he went, people admired his talent, but they also wanted to learn his methods. So he began giving classes, and in 1896, he wrote his first book. Jesse Beery was on top of the world. He was tireless, he was fearless. And for the next 8 years, his fame continued to grow. But in 1904, at the age of 43, Jesse Beery reached a crossroads. He was a husband and father that was away from home far too much. His health was deteriorating, and the danger of his work made it impossible to buy insurance to protect his family. Beery could not go on making his living as a traveling horse tamer. He had to find another way. And the choice that he made would separate him once and for all from every horseman the world has known. The path Jesse Beery chose at that crossroads was to develop a correspondence school in horsemanship, a real business in one location, where he could keep regular hours, maybe even walk to work, and be home for dinner with his family. In 1908, he offered his first course, Professor Beery's Illustrated Course in Horse Training, 8 pocket-sized blue booklets. The subjects were colt training, disposition and subjection, kicking and balking, shying and running away, bad to shoe and halter pulling, miscellaneous habits, pony training and special fears, and teaching tricks to horses and dogs. Along with the books, the student received an official certificate. The following year, Jesse published a 5-part series on riding and training the saddle horse. It too came with an official certificate. In the first 5 years, more than 30,000 students from around the world ordered Professor Beery's correspondence courses, and many of them wrote back to him to thank him, to tell him of their successes, and to beg him for the opportunity to see him work in person. This got Jesse to thinking. The truth was, he missed performing and working with difficult horses. So what came about were the Beery exhibitions of 1910 through 1913. They were part homecoming party for his students, part promotion of his school to the public, and all entertainment. At the 1913 event in Dayton, one of Jesse's demonstrations drew 12,000 people, more than Buffalo Bill or Barnum and Bailey had drawn at that venue. Total attendance that week exceeded 100,000 people. It had to have been a heady time for Professor Jesse Beery. The American horse population was at its peak of nearly 26 million, and every one of those horses needed training. Jesse had regained his health and had honed his showmanship skills to an even finer edge. At his side, as always, was his faithful assistant, Roy Coppock, Almeida's cousin. Together they battled the wildest stallions, gentled the spookiest horses, and thrilled every man, woman, and child who watched. The 1913 exhibitions were Jesse Beery's final public performance taming a horse. At 52, he was ready to once again concentrate on his school. He expressed his feelings at the time by saying this, "As I look back over my encounters with dangerous horses, I like to think that the narrow escapes, the many hardships, and even the many mistakes I've made have not been in vain. That in spite of them, or perhaps because of them, human lives have been saved, and there has been brought about throughout the world a better understanding of the horse." One of the first things Beery wanted his students to understand was that horses think very differently from humans. "The horse cannot reason like a human," he said. "The horse recognizes only objects and actions, what he gets immediately through his keen senses, while man goes beyond and back of that to the cause and effect." Beery also taught that horses fall into four general types. Type 1 is the teachable, kind horse. Type 2 is the stubborn, willful horse. Type 3 is the nervous, ambitious, determined horse. And type 4 is the treacherous, ill-tempered, resentful horse. Jesse Beery believed that you can identify a horse's type by simply looking at its head. This is called phrenology, and it's been around for a long time. Jesse Beery believed that horse training should be tailored to the type of horse you have, to its good tendencies and the bad ones. He wrote, "If he is properly trained, these bad tendencies are kept in the background and allowed to perish unused, while the weaker tendencies are brought to the front and strengthened by use." Beery set out to prove this with Charlie, a 2-year-old blood bay Hambletonian or standard bred horse that he purchased in 1888. Beery's plan was to make Charlie into a trick horse. He also wanted to see if Charlie could be taught to drive with no bridle, no bit, and no reins, something that had never been done before. Now, Beery taught Charlie his basic commands and then taught him to take his cues from whip signals. Now, Beery used a full-size buggy whip, but you'll get the idea. Pointing the whip forward meant get up. Bringing the whip to a 45-degree angle meant slow down. Pointing the whip straight up meant whoa. Tapping the horse on the right shoulder meant turn right. Tapping on the left shoulder meant turn left. And making a backward motion with the whip meant to back up. Charlie learned the whip signals so thoroughly that he could be driven through crowded city streets and up and down steps with nothing but the whip to guide him. All this from a horse that was a type 2-3 combination: stubborn, willful, nervous, ambitious, and determined. Beery said of Charlie, "These natural qualities were so overcome by patient training that he has been considered one of the greatest trick horses in the world. And the crowds that saw him perform often expressed the opinion that he had more sense than any horse living." Professor Jesse Beery brought empathetic, psychological horse training into the 20th century, and his Correspondence School of Horsemanship taught 300,000 students from around the world in its 62-year history. Beery used his trick horse, Charlie, as a flesh-and-blood example of the power of the Beery training methods. But he used two fictional horses, Kate and Queen, to express the Beery philosophy. Kate was a beautiful, spirited filly, But the training she received was impatient and rough. It confused and frightened her, and eventually she became an outlaw, angry and untouchable. Kate's daughter, Queen, was trained very differently, with kindness, consistency, and patience. Queen grew to understand and trust humans. She became a perfectly safe and dependable family horse. There is no doubt that Jesse Beery loved and respected horses, but he was a practical man living in a time when horses were essential to everyday life. His methods were designed to produce results. At the heart of his method was the concept of subjection, the process of convincing a horse that the human had absolute control of him, no matter how much he might resist. For the complete subjection treatment, Beery used a one-leg hobble and laid the horse down, just as John Rary and others before him had done. This virtually guaranteed an attitude change in the horse. In other instances, especially to teach the whoa command to a driving horse, Beery used his double safety rope. This was a half-inch cotton rope, 18 feet long, that was run through rings on a surcingle to both front feet, forming a configuration that came to be known as a running W. The double safety rope gave Beery control of both front feet with a single rope. If necessary, he could bring the horse to its knees, which were always padded to prevent injury. Horses learned very quickly. If Beery didn't need that degree of control, he connected the rope to just one leg. Beery also spent a great deal of time working on a horse's confidence and courage by desensitizing him to a wide array of stimuli, including something that was new back then, the automobile. Professor Beery had some rather ingenious solutions for behavior problems, such as pulling back on the halter, resisting shoeing, jumping fences, pawing, and refusing to back. In each case, the horse punished itself when it did something wrong. Now, some of these were old horse tamer tricks that have been around for a long time. Although the vast majority of Beery's students were men, there were a significant number of women and children also using the methods. Nothing made Professor Beery happier than seeing his students succeed. One key to the success of any horseman is having the right tools, and Professor Jesse Beery took great pride in what he called his appliances. Their purpose was to keep the handler safe, to accomplish the desired goal effectively, and to do it with as little discomfort and anxiety for the horse as possible. Beery wrote, "I wanted something with which I could compel a horse to do what I wanted him to, something I could take off after I was through with it, without the horse realizing that he had been at a disadvantage all the time." In other words, the Beery appliances helped him outsmart the horse. Examples of Beery's appliances included the surcingle, the pulley-breaking bridle, the safety rope, the guy line, the foot strap, the knee pads, and the Beery 4-in-1 bit. But the short-turn runabout was Professor Beery's most ingenious invention. It was a lightweight but durable four-wheel, two-seater buggy. Because of its unique axle configuration, very short turns were possible, and upsetting it was almost impossible. Now that was a big deal. Professor Jesse Beery made a difference. No one since John Rary had done so much for horses and the people who used them. Beery put responsibility squarely where it belongs, on the human. In 1896, he wrote, "I claim there is no horse naturally vicious. They are always made that way by bad management or ignorant trainers." He believed in being kind to horses, but also in being absolutely clear about what was expected. He understood the strength and the sensitivity of horses, and he used both in their training. In order to effect a change in a horse, Beery's methods often pushed the horse deeply into survival mode, into reacting rather than thinking, until he gave up the fight. Now, there's nothing wrong with this. It works. And what Beery taught his students allowed countless working horses to live in peace with their owners. Are the Beery methods worth studying today? Absolutely. Are they as good as more modern methods? Well, that's a tough question to answer because the context is so different today. Horses are almost entirely recreational animals now, and their breeding is better. If Jesse Beery lived today, chances are the good professor himself would want to make a few changes here and there to his methods. In case you are wondering, Jesse Beery was related to the family of actors named Beery. And this is how it went. Jesse's second cousin was grandfather to Academy Award-winning actor Wallace Beery and his brother Noah, and great-grandfather to Noah Beery Jr. Now let's see, that would make Wallace and Noah Jesse's second cousin twice removed, and Noah Jr. Jesse's second cousin three times removed. Professor Jesse Beery lived a long, full life and died February 22, 1945 at the age of 83. He's buried here in Pleasant Hill, just a few blocks from where he lived and worked. After Jesse's death, his sons Ray and Beecher continued the family business for another 25 years before selling it in 1970. Beery was all but forgotten until fairly recently when he came alive in cyberspace. Today, thanks to the internet, the work of Jesse Beery is once again available, and students of the horse can once again learn from the professor.